Hello students, welcome to the fourth class of the module 3 of your computer graphics and visualization. In the previous class, we have discussed the translation, rotation, scaling, reflection, and shear operation. So, and in the previous class, we have seen some of the concept of the chapter number 10, that is the illumination models and the surface rendering methods. In that we have discussed what is a light source, okay, and what are the types of light sources, okay. As we have seen that it consists of point light source, distant light source, then spotlight light source, okay. So along with that, we have seen some set of equations, okay, with respect to the attenuation, okay. And today's class, we are going to discuss the remaining concept of this chapter number 10, okay. So those are the basic illumination models. In that, we are going to study the ambient light, diffuse reflection, specular reflection. And after that, we will discuss what is this form model and what is this modified form model. Okay, so you can see here, I didn't include any of the concept in this model 3 PPT. Okay, so I have written everything in the notes. Okay, and that I have scanned. Okay, and that I have uploaded in your Moodle. Okay, but yes, in the textbook 1, okay, it is already given the content, okay, but what I felt is it is somewhat difficult for the students to understand, okay. So that is why I have gone through the textbook 2, okay, because there also we have the same concept, but the author has explained in a very neat and easy method, okay. So I'm going to use the textbook 2, okay, for this ambient light, diffuse, specular form model, and modified form model. Okay. So basic illumination models. In that we will see what is this Phong lighting model. Okay. So in the Phong lighting model, okay, we will come across with the three important terms. Those were ambient, diffuse, and specular. Okay, before going into these terms, okay, first let us understand what is this lighting model. Okay, so the scientist named Phong, okay, he has introduced these lighting models. Okay, what he has done, okay, he has taken one surface, okay, a part of a surface, okay, part of any material surface, okay, on which he has taken one point, okay, one arbitrary point he has taken. Okay, so this I is nothing but what? It is nothing but it is the light, okay, the light from where the light is coming. Okay, so you can see that the arrow is directed towards the outside, right, which indicates that this point P, it is getting the light source which is coming from that side. Okay, but in reality, from this light is coming from this side to this side, right, but the point will come to know that, okay, I'm getting the light from this point. Okay, so for that purpose only we have represented in this way. What is I? I is nothing but it is a kind of vector. Okay, we will use a kind of vector. Why we are going to use the vector? Because vector consists of a magnitude as well as the direction. Okay, so here the direction and the magnitude means what is the distance, okay, between the light source and this given material surface. Okay, yes, as we know that when the light falls on this particular surface, it is going to reflect, right? It is going to reflect back. Okay, for that we are going to use this particular new vector called R. Okay, R stands for reflection vector. Okay, so and along with that, we are going to take one perpendicular vector, okay, from this surface, okay, from this surface, okay, with the reference, with the help of this point P. Okay, we are going to take a perpendicular vector. And that we call it as a vector n. Okay, n stands for it is a normal vector. Okay, normal vectors are always perpendicular to the any surface. Okay, And in between this normal vector and this reflection vector, we are going to use another vector called V. Okay, what is this V? V is nothing but the viewer. Okay, viewer. Okay, so here either the camera or the particular viewer is standing and they are observing that particular point P. Okay, so whenever the assume that there is a no light. Okay, so whenever the light falls on that particular surface, okay, based upon the material of that property, okay, either it may show that it is very dull, okay, otherwise it will show that it is very smooth, in means it is going to reflect that it is very shiny. Okay, that is nothing but based upon the angle of incidence to the angle of reflection. Okay, if the surface is smooth, we will get the kind of shininess. If the surface is rough, we will get a kind of dull surface. Okay, so the viewer can view that what type of the property, okay, what type of behavior that it can, that can be observed on this particular point P. Okay, so in the fog lighting model, we are going to use four vectors. Those were, one is the illumination vector. Okay, I is nothing but we call it as a illumination, means the lighting vector, light from where the light is coming, but we are not going to use the light here, we will name it as a illumination. I stands for illumination vector. Okay, and next one we are going to use the normal vector. Okay, and next one is a viewer vector, and finally the reflection vector. Okay, so there are four vectors we are going to use to calculate a color for an arbitrary point P on the surface. Okay, when we are going to use this, whenever I want to know what is the color of this particular point P on this particular surface. Okay, I can't judge the color of that one, only when the light will fall on it, then only I can easily observe. Okay, and whenever it is going to reflect back, I can understand the characteristics of that particular point P. Okay, and yes, the incidence has happened, reflection has happened, someone should be there to view, right? For that we are going to use the viewer. Okay, if the surface is curved, all the four vectors change as we move from point to point. Okay, what is the meaning of this one is, if assume that this surface is a flat one, okay, if you change the point, okay, if you change the point from here to here, okay, yes, you are going to get the same vector, okay, with the same angle between them. Okay, but assume that if the surface is curved, okay, if the surface is curved, okay, whenever you are going to change the point P, okay, on that surface, okay, the angular distances between this I, N, V and R will going to get changed. Okay, that is the meaning of this one. Okay, so vector n is normal at a point P. Okay, yes, I have said that the normal vector, which is always perpendicular to the given surface. The next vector V is the direction from P to the viewer. Okay, or center of projection. COP is nothing but we call it as a center of projection. What is the center of projection? A point where all the projections are going to meet, that we call it as a center of projections. Okay, so the best example for this center of projection is nothing but in our eyes. Okay, so whatever the scenes are there in front of us, okay, every projections will come, okay, to our eye, and it is going to fall on our retina, so that we can identify the complete scene which is there in front of us. Okay, the next one is vector I. It is the direction of a line from P to an arbitrary point. Okay, in short, we call it as it is a illumination vector. Okay, from where the light is coming. The next one, vector R. R is nothing but it is a reflection vector. Okay, we will think that the particular surface is going to exhibit the perfect reflectivity. Okay, perfect reflectivity. Okay, so we will think that the angle of incidence is always equal to that of angle of reflection. Okay, so how we can determine the R? Okay, R is determined by using the N and I. Okay, once we know what is the N, okay, what is the I, we can easily identify the R. Okay, I hope you can recall your physics. Okay, so see here, if this is the angle of incidence, then we are going to apply the normal vector. Then we have this theta I, okay, that is the incident angle. Okay, so with the help of this normal vector, now we can identify the angle of reflection also, right? That is a theta R. Okay, I hope you can remember your Snell's law that you have studied in your physics. Okay, that is a sine theta I is equals to sine theta R. Okay, then Yes. Now, the form model supports three types of light material interaction. Okay, light material interaction. Okay, what he's saying here is, okay, whenever the light is having its own characteristics, right? That is the impact of the location of that light source, the color of the light source, the intensity, the brightness of that light source. Okay, these are all the characteristics of the light source. What about the material? Okay, material characteristics are nothing but the material may be either smooth or it may be rough. Okay, what do you mean by rough? Rough is in it is nothing but the surface. Okay, the surface is having some kind of zigzag lines. Okay, that we are going to see in the upcoming concept. Okay, what about the smooth? Smooth is nothing but the entire surface is a polished one. Okay, entire surface is polished one. Okay, so this light and material, okay, whenever they will interact with each other, okay, they are going to exhibit the new behavior. Okay, they are going to exhibit the new behavior of that particular that scene. Okay, so assume that a particular material is there. Okay, assume that a spear, okay, a white spear is there. Okay, white spear. Okay, and its surface is completely polished. Okay, assume that whenever the red light, okay, red light, okay, from some distance, if it is coming and it is sitting on the this particular white sphere, okay, can I get a white sphere itself? No, right? I'm going to get a kind of red sphere. Okay, why? Because the red light is falling on that material. Okay, and the material is having some kind of a smoothness. Okay, so that I will feel that it is having some kind of shininess. Okay. So in that we have the three types: ambient, diffuse, and specular. Okay, so ambient, diffuse, and specular plays a very important role, okay, in this form model. Okay, now before going to this ambient, diffuse, and specular, okay, let us understand some of the concept of colors. Okay, colors and light sources. Okay, just you have to remember these three terms: ambient, diffuse, and specular. Okay, in the next we are going to use these things. Next, suppose that we have a set of point sources. Okay, we have already discussed what is a point source. Okay, point source is nothing but it is a kind of light source in which it is going to illuminate the light in all the direction uniformly. Okay, each source can have separate ambient, diffuse, and specular component for each of the three primary colors. Okay, so it is saying that any point sources, okay, having its own ambient, diffuse, and specular components, okay, with the three primary colors, which are those three primary colors: red, green, and blue. Okay, if our light source has a separate ambient, diffuse, specular terms, we need nine coefficients, okay, to characterize a light source at any point P on the surface. What is this nine coefficient? The nine coefficients are nothing but it is a 3x3 illumination array. Okay, 3x3 illumination array. Okay, where I is nothing but the number of light sources that you are going to use. Okay, so Li. Okay, Li is nothing but the ith number of light sources that you are going to use. Okay, that is equals to, okay, so LIRA. Okay, what is the meaning of this one? It is the ith light source which is having the red component and the ambient component. Okay, the next one, LIGA. Okay, ith light source, the green component and ambient component. Okay, similarly, this one is the ith light source, okay, with the blue component and ambient component. Okay, when you come to the next one, here ith light source with the red component and diffuse. Okay, similarly, ith light, okay, green and diffuse, ith light blue and diffuse, ith light red and specular, ith light green and specular, ith light blue and specular. Okay, so here we can see that the complete rows, okay, are dependent on the ambient, diffuse, and specular. Okay, the rows, the sorry columns, okay, this is completely red component. The second row, second column is completely green component. The third column is completely blue component. Okay, in this way we are going to place the coefficients. Okay, for this ith light sources. Okay, so here I is equals to either 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. Okay, but I have already said that in the open shell, we have only 8 light sources. Okay, 8 light sources, maximum 8 light sources we can use. Okay, next. Yes, this is the light. Okay, means incoming light. Next, we have to compute the amount of light reflected. Okay, reflected back each of the 9 terms in the illumination array. Yes, this light is falling on the surface, right? Now it should reflect back, right? For that, what we are going to use, for each point we have 9 coefficients that can place the array of reflection terms. Okay, that is ri equals to rira, rigA, rida. Okay, the same thing. Okay, whatever that you have written over here, same thing you are going to write it over here also. But previously there was incoming light, L was there, but now here we are going to use the reflection. Okay, we are going to use the reflection. Okay, so this LIRA and IRA, okay, both are associated with each other. Okay, because it is the incoming light and this is the outgoing light, okay, which is nothing but reflection. Okay, these both are having a kind of dependency. Okay, but this one and this one, they are not dependent. Okay, because it is red and this is green. Okay, both are different. Okay, I hope you understood. The first coefficient of the Li is having the relationship with the first coefficient of the Ri. Okay, similarly for the others also. Okay, so let us take one example. For a red diffuse, okay, red diffuse is there for the ith light source, okay, that is LIRD, okay, diffuse and red. We can compute the reflection term RIRD, okay, and later we can contribute to the intensity at the P is nothing but IRIRD into LIRD, okay. What is the meaning of this one is, okay, when we want to see the total contribution on that particular point P, okay, that we want to determine, that can be determined with the help of, okay, assume that that particular point is having the diffuse and the red one, okay, which is taken from the light source, okay. So that is this LIRA, okay, multiplied with the RIRA, okay. So we are going to get the red with the ambient, okay, for that point P, okay, that is the total, that is a contribution to the intensity, okay. But here in the example, we have taken the red diffuse. Red diffuse means this red diffuse LIRD and RIRD, okay, that will be taken together, okay. The value of RIRD depends on the material properties, okay. So here this LIRA, LIRD, LIRS and all the coefficients are depends on the light material, light properties, okay. But the reflection is always depends on the material properties, okay. So material properties, orientation of the surface, direction of the light source and the distance between the light source and the viewer, okay. Then next, we can then compute the contribution for each color source by adding the ambient, diffuse and specular component. Okay, so what he's saying here is, if we want to know the total contribution of this light and material, okay, on this point P, what we are going to use, we are going to use all this ambient, specular and diffuse, okay. Okay, all this component with the green, blue and green, okay, everything we are going to consider together, okay. For example, here assume that I want to calculate only the red intensity, okay. I want to find it out only the red intensity which is there on the point P, okay, from the source I. What I can do, okay, I will take the reflection and the light, okay. So IRA, okay, why IRA? Because red, okay, red. Okay, but he is not talking about any ambient, diffuse and specular. So we are going to use all the things. So RIRA into LIRA plus RIRD, okay, into LIRD plus RIRS into LIRS. Okay, so see here, the red is common, Okay, because we want to see the total contribution of the red intensity irrespective of the ambient diffusion specula. Okay, so what we will get? We will get the I. Okay, what is this I? I is nothing but it is the total. See here the I is nothing but it is a total intensity with respect to the this particular I light source RA. Okay, red with the ambient. This is the total contribution. Okay, intensity contribution. Okay, so here don't get confused that previously we have used the I. Okay, that is the incoming light. Okay, but here we will say it as an intensity. Okay, I is nothing but intensity here. So whenever we will multiply these two, okay, we will get a total contribution, total intensity, that is IRA. Okay, similarly for this one IRD. Okay, and next one IRS. Okay, next we obtain the total intensity by adding the contribution of all the sources and also the global ambient term. Okay, that is the red term. Okay, what is the meaning of this one is, now we are going to add the contribution of all the light sources. Okay, all the light sources means summation of 1 to n. Okay, from I to n. Okay, means it may be 2, 3, 4, like that, any number of light sources. Okay, that we are going to add together. Okay, so that we will get a only the red intensity. Okay, red intensity plus IAR. Okay, IAR is nothing but it is a red component of the ambient light. Okay, what is this red component of the ambient light means? Assume that a particular room is there. Okay, the room is there, the completely it is black. Okay, yeah, it does not have any light in that. Okay, none of the light is coming from outside. Okay, and inside also there is no light. Okay, so assume that in the light in the room, okay, every wall is painted with a white color. Okay, the room walls are painted with a white color. Okay, if I put a red bulb, okay, in the middle of the room, okay, and if I switch on, okay, if I switch on, okay, now what is the color of my room? It will be red, right? So there is an equal amount of radiation of red light, okay, to the all the surfaces, okay, to the all the surfaces of the particular room, right? So that our room will looks like a complete red color. Okay, that is we called as a local ambient term. Okay, this is our local ambient term. What about this global ambient term? Assume that in that particular room, if I open the window from outside, okay, some amount of red light is going to enter into the room. Okay, that light we call it as a global ambient term. Okay, that we call it as a global ambient term. This is the local one and this is the global one. Okay, so to simplify our notation by noting that the necessary computation for each source and each primary color, they differ depending on whether we considering ambient, diffuse or specular terms. So we are going to omit all these subscripts, that is the ith light source, red, green and blue, all these things we are going to eliminate. What we will get? We will get a IA, that is the intensity with respect to the ambient, then intensity with respect to the diffuse, then intensity with respect to specular. Okay, so we will get, that is a total intensity contribution. Okay, total intensity contribution, okay, on that particular point P. Okay, so what is IA? I is nothing but LA into RA. What is L? L is nothing but incoming light. R is nothing but reflection, okay, with respect to the ambient. Similarly for incoming light and reflection with respect to diffuse. Incoming light and reflection with respect to specular. I hope you understood. Okay, so this is the Phong equation that we are going to use. Okay, but see, this Phong equation is very general in case. Okay, so we have to simplify further. Okay, so we have to elaborate further. Okay, because we don't know what type of material that we are going to use. Okay, so this is our basic equation. Okay, so let us assume that this is the equation number one, okay, on which now whatever the IA, okay, ID and IS that we are going to get, okay, that we are going to substitute, and finally we are going to get the I. Okay, now, yes, this is not a problem, LA, LD, LS, okay, that is the incoming light, okay, with respect to the ambient diffusion specula. But the main problem here is that is R, okay, because R is going to determine by the help of that material characteristic, okay, what is the type of that material, okay, whether it is smooth or rough, okay, that we are going to see here, okay. So with respect to this R, okay, we are going to study ambient reflection, diffuse reflection, and specular reflection. What is the ambient reflection? Okay, what is the ambient? Ambient is nothing but if a light source is going to emit the light in all the direction, okay, with the equal intensity, with the equal brightness, okay, that we call it as an ambient, okay, means uniformity. Ambient means uniformity. Okay, with respect to that ambient reflection, okay, the intensity of the ambient light IA, is the same at every point on the surface. Okay, recall that example, that room with a red light. Okay, so that we will get a complete red colored room. Okay, some of this light is absorbed and some of it is reflected, right? It depends on the material. Okay, the particular wall, okay, can absorb and it is going to reflect back. The amount of reflected is given by the ambient reflection coefficient. So amount of reflection, okay, that is normally taken in a form of constant, okay, that is RA is equals to KA. Okay, what is a KA? KA is nothing but it is a ambient reflection coefficient, okay, where its value is in between 0 to 1. Okay, 0 is the minimum value and 1 is the maximum value. Okay, and thus we are going to change. See here, IA, okay, that is a ambient, okay, ambient intensity, that is equals to we have LA into RA, right? LA into RA, but now RA is equals to KA, right? So we are going to change, that is KA into LA. Okay, KA into LA. So we are not going to use the RA, we are going to use the KA. Okay, where KA value is ranges between 0 to 1. Okay, 0 indicates it is completely the color is there. Okay, means the complete color. Okay, means the uniformity will be uniformity is completely absent, or 1 means uniformity is completely present. Okay, a surface has a 3 ambient coefficients, that is KAR, KAG and KAS. Okay, so that is nothing but ambient coefficient with respect to red, green and blue. Okay, this is not K. Yes, it is a B. Okay, so it is a blue ambient coefficient. Okay, so it depends on which type of primary color that you are going to use. The next one, diffuse reflection. Okay, what is this diffuse reflection? As the name itself says, that diffusing. Okay, so whatever the light is coming inside, that will be diffused in other directions. Okay, we can't say that it is going to diffuse in all the direction with the equal amount of intensity. Okay, it depends upon the angle of incidence and angle of reflection. Okay, so a perfectly diffused reflector scatters the light that it reflects equally in all the direction. Okay, so perfectly diffused reflector is going to always diffuse the light equally in all the direction. Hence, such surfaces appear same to all the viewer. Okay, the amount of light reflected depends on the material because of the incoming light is absorbed on the position of the light source relative to the surface. Okay, what is the meaning of this one is, if assume that, okay, let us see with an example. Okay, see, diffuse reflections are categorized by the rough surfaces. So all the diffuse surfaces, okay, are nothing but rough surfaces. Okay, diffuse surfaces are rough surfaces. If we were magnify the cross section of the diffuse surface, okay, assume that there is a surface. If you take the cross sectional view of this one, you can get a kind of zigzag line like this. So whenever the light falls on that particular surface, it's going to reflect. So see here angle of reflection, okay, and see the angle of reflection over here. They're completely different, Okay, so angle of incidence is different from the angle of reflection. Because of this concept, okay, whatever the viewer location, okay, that particular surface always looks same and it always looks dull. Okay. The ray of light that hits the surface at only the slightly different angles are reflected back at markedly different angles. So it is not going to obey the Snell's law. Okay. Perfectly diffuse surfaces are so rough that there is no preferred angle of reflection. Okay, so such type of surfaces also we call it as a Lambertian surfaces. Okay, so these surfaces we call it as a diffuse surfaces, or we call it as a rough surfaces, or also we call it as a Lambertian surfaces. Okay, so Lambertian is nothing but is a name of a scientist. Okay, who named that surfaces. Okay. So that surfaces can be modeled mathematically with the help of Lambert's law. Okay, what is this Lambert's law? Okay, assume there is a diffuse planar surface. The best example for this one is our Earth only. Okay, Earth surface. Okay, so as you seen that during the morning time. Okay, morning means during the noon time. Okay, noon time. Okay, the light is exactly falling on the surface. Okay, vertically, this is we call it as a vertical contribution. Okay, vertical contribution. So in this case, what is going to happen? This particular surface is going to get a more energy, more heat. Okay, it is going to get. Okay, so because the light radiations are falling. Okay, exactly on the surface. Okay, so the vertical contribution is happening. Okay, from that surface we are going to take one normal vector. Okay, why we are taking the normal vector, that we are going to see next concept. Okay, so and assume that this is the same surface during the morning, early morning or the evening time. Okay, so now there is a spread of light sources. This particular surface won't get that much of energy whichever it was getting at the noon time. Okay, so the energy is the sun and its energy is same. Okay, but because of this oblique nature. Okay, it is going to, this particular surface is going to absorb the less amount of energy. Okay, I hope in your geography you have studied. Okay, that is nothing but the earth and in the equatorial region we will get more light. Okay, and in the tropical regions and the subtropical region, temperate region, and in the polar region, you will get that we won't get that much of energy from the sun because of the kind of curve. Okay, because of the oblique placement of the surface and between and the sun. Okay. So that is what he written here. Okay, the surface is the brightest at the noon, dimmest at the morning and evening. Okay, according to the Lambert's law, we see only the vertical component of the incoming light. Okay, to understand this law, you can take one more example. That is nothing but you can take the torch. Okay, keep it vertically to your table. Okay, and switch on. Okay, so when you switch on, okay, assume that this is the torch, okay, and this is the distance, okay, from where that particular light, okay, means the complete width of that particular torch from where the light is coming. Okay, so it is going to perform the equal contribution to that particular surface. Okay, so whatever the distance was there in that particular torch, the same amount of distance we can observe here also. Okay, but once you made some angle, okay, between that surface and that particular torch, okay, now you can see that now the light is somewhat dispersed. Okay, light is somewhat dispersed, so now this particular table surface, okay, will not get that much intense light as it is getting before. Okay, so the normal vector is used to measure the theta, okay, the angle between this incoming light L and this normal vector m. Okay, this is what we call as a vertical contribution by the Lambert's law. Okay, so here this distance is nothing but d by cos theta. Okay, d by cos theta. I hope you remember what is a cos theta. Okay, I'm not going to explain what is a cos theta. Okay, just by looking at the figure, okay, you have to analyze. Okay, the same amount of light is spread over the large area. Okay, for this one, surface appears dimmer. Okay, whenever we use this one. Okay, we can characterize the diffuse reflection mathematically by the Lambert's law. What is the Lambert's law saying? That is nothing but this reflection. Okay, the reflection whatever we are going to get. Okay, from this kind of surfaces. Okay, because angle of incidence and the angle of reflection both are different. So that is equals to RD is directly proportional to the cos theta. Okay, cos theta is nothing but the angle made. Okay, between this the incoming light and this normal vector. Okay, so this theta is nothing but it is the angle between normal at the point of the interest and the direction of the light source L. Okay, if we take that this both L and N are unit length vectors. Okay, which is having the value 1. Okay, we are just determining their directions. Okay, we are not going to think about their distances. Okay. Just if we assume that it's a unit length vector, we will get, okay, what we will get if we add in a reflection coefficient, okay, KD to represent the fraction of the incoming diffuse light as reflected, we have the diffuse reflection term. That is, let's recollect that equation number 1, that was ID equals to RD into LD, right? So there, what we are going to use, okay, that is, in the place of RD, we are going to use KD, okay? KD into L dot N, okay? L dot N, it is not a multiplication, it is a dot vector, okay? Dot vector operation that we are going to perform. Means L dot N is equal to that of your cos theta, okay? In a kind of polar form, we are going to use the cos theta, okay? But in a vector form, we are going to take it as a L dot N, okay? So RD equals to some constant into cos theta, right? So what is the constant here? That is a KD. Okay, what is the value of a KD? It is lies in between 0 to 1. Okay, so KD into L into N. Okay, so we are going to replace KD into L dot N into LD. Okay, you can use cos theta also. Okay, but normally we are not going to use the cos theta and all because everything is on the vectors. So we will use L dot N. Okay. To incorporate the distance term to account for attenuation as the light travels at distance D from the source to the surface. Now assume that there is a particular distances, okay, distance between the light source and the material. Okay. So some amount of attenuation can be observed. What is attenuation? Attenuation is nothing but the drop in the energy. Okay, suddenly the energy will be dropped. Okay, so best example for this one is the distance between the sun and earth. Okay, so as we know that the sun is too much, is having high energy. Okay, but we won't, it is having so much high degree of Celsius temperature will be there, but we won't feel that much. Okay, because there is a distance between the earth and sun. Okay, so the whatever that energy is coming from the sun towards the earth, okay, that will be dropped. That we call it as an attenuation. Okay, so here we are going to use the quadratic attenuation term. Okay, so that is ID equals to KD. KD is nothing but it is a diffuse coefficient term. Okay, which is a constant. Okay, L dot N into LD whole divided by A plus BD plus CD square. Okay, here this D is nothing but it is a distance between the light source and the material. Okay, whereas A, B, C are nothing but a softening coefficient. Okay, softening coefficient. About this one, I have already explained in the previous class. Okay, just to go through that one. Okay, now problem with this expression here is L dot N into LD will become negative. Yes. If the light source is below the horizon, okay, in this case we want to use zero rather than negative values. Hence we are going to use max of L dot N into LD comma zero. What is the meaning of this one is, assume that our light source is on the or is or here, okay? But assume that if the light source comes below to the horizon, if this is the horizon, if it comes below to the horizon, okay, what we are going to get? We are going to get negative values, okay? But we don't want the negative values. We want either zero, okay, otherwise positive values, okay? But we don't want any negative values. For that, we are going to make some changes in this particular equation, okay? So we are going to use max of L dot N into LD comma zero, okay? So this is the, this expression will give us only the positive values, okay? But not the negative values. So here you have to make this equation ID equals to KD divided by A plus BD plus CD square, but here max of L dot N into LD comma zero, okay? This is our diffuse reflection, okay? This is our diffuse reflection, okay? So we have already computed this ambient reflection. We got the equation as I equals to K into LA, okay? Take it as a equation number two, okay? And for this diffuse reflection, we have got the equation that is ID equals to KD by A plus BD plus CD square max of L dot N into LD comma zero, that we are going to take it as equation number three, okay? Next one, specular reflection, okay? Specular reflections are nothing but these are the materials, okay, whose surfaces are smooth, okay? They are a very polished one, okay? So what is the use of this specular reflection? If we employ only the ambient and diffuse reflections over the images, we will be shaded and will appear three-dimensional, okay? But all the surfaces will look dull, yes? So if we use only the diffuse, okay, and the ambient, yes, we will, even though we can apply this material properties on the three-dimensional object, we will get, but a kind of shininess we are going to miss, okay? So our surface will always looks dull, okay? So for that, we are going to use this specular, okay? The best example for this one is, assume that there is a person, okay, who is completely bald, okay? And who is completely bald, okay? Whenever he come outside, okay, in front of the sunlight, his head is going to shine, right? Because its surface, the head surface is completely smooth, okay? Because of that, the reflection can be observed, okay? If that that scalp is more smooth, then the more shininess can be observed, okay? That is what the specular, okay? What we are missing are the highlights that we see reflected from the shiny object. See, if this is the object, we want to see a kind of shininess, okay? Assume that from here the light is coming, okay, so that we can get a kind of shininess, okay? A diffuse surface, as we know that it is a rough surface, specular surfaces are smooth surface, okay? Because these surfaces will obey the Snell's law, that is angle of incidence is equal to that of angle of reflection, okay? So in the throughout the surfaces, we will see the same angle of incidence and angle of reflection will be same, okay? So we consider the surface as being rough for the diffuse and smooth for the specular term, okay? The amount of light does that the viewer sees depends on the angle phi, okay? So here in this specular, okay, the viewer's position plays very important role, okay? Because for example, if you take that same example, that bald person, okay, yes, the reflection is happening, okay, that the shininess is happening on his scalp, okay, but someone is there to view, right? Okay, if assume that you are the viewer, okay, but assume that you are backside of him, okay, so you are not going to see that, okay, so you have to come in front of him so that you can see the shininess, okay, on his scalp, okay, so the viewer position also plays very important role, okay, so the amount of light does that the viewer sees depends on the angle phi, okay? So that angle phi between the R, the direction of the perfect reflection, and V direction, okay? What is the meaning of this one is, as we go back to this particular Phong model, okay, so here see the viewer, okay, viewer is in between the normal vector and the reflection vector. Okay, if he is very near to the reflection, he can get the more shininess, he can observe the more shininess, okay, from that point P. Okay, I hope you got my point. Okay, if he is away from that particular reflection, he will get very less part of the shininess. Okay, so here kind of imagination you should make, okay, some kind of analysis you should do. Okay, everything I can't do. Okay, so that phi is the angle, okay, it is the angle between the reflection, okay, and the viewer V, okay, okay, the Phong model uses the equation. This is for the specular, that is Ks, okay, Ks is nothing but it is a specular reflection coefficient, okay, into Ls, okay, that is a specular light source, cos phi, okay, what is a phi? Phi is nothing but it is an angular distance between the R and V, okay, if this phi is very small, okay, we will get the more shininess, okay, more shininess, okay, so this raised to alpha, this alpha is nothing but it is an exponent, okay, shininess coefficient, okay, this exponent alpha we call it as a shininess coefficient. Here, as the alpha increases, the reflected light is concentrated in a narrower region, okay, centered on the angle of the perfect reflector, okay, means if this alpha value increases, okay, we will get in a one particular location more shininess we can observe, okay, highly intense reflection we can observe, okay, as this alpha value increases, okay, as the alpha value goes infinity, we get a mirror, okay, the best example for this one is mirror, okay, so mirror, okay, whenever you keep the mirror on the surface, okay, and whenever you put the torch, okay, when you perform the vertical contribution of the light, okay, on that particular mirror, okay, so light is going to reflect back, okay, light is going to reflect back because mirror is going to observe, which is going to follow the Snell's law, angle of incidence is equal to that of angle of reflection because it is a smooth surface, okay, so that we will get a kind of more shininess on that mirror surface, okay, values in the range of 100 to 500 we will get a kind of metallic surface, okay, metallic surface, okay, that kind of look we can observe on our object, okay, if the alpha value is in between 100 to 500. If the alpha value is less than 100, okay, we will get the broad highlight, okay, broader highlight, okay, means in the particular concentrated shininess we won't see, a broader shininess we can see, okay, so see here, okay, if the alpha value is equals to 1, okay, very less value, so a broader, okay, broader shininess we can see, but it always looks dull, okay, but as the alpha value increases, okay, in a particular position, okay, highly concentrated shininess we can see, okay, finally in the Phong model we have the normalized R and N, okay, R and N to the unit length specular term will becomes, okay, Ks into Ls max of R dot V raised to alpha comma 0. What we have done here, so here cos phi is the thing, but it is angular angle between R dot V, right? Yes, cos phi is the angle between R and V, okay, so we are going to use R dot V, okay, so R dot V raised to alpha, okay, so here also we will get the same case, okay, so if this alpha goes, okay, if this angular distance goes below the origin, okay, below the origin, okay, we may get the negative values. For that we are going to use max of R dot V raised to alpha comma 0, okay, so let us take this equation as the fourth equation, okay, now substitute this equation number 2, 3 and 4 in the equation number 1, what we will get the total contribution, okay, of the intensity, that is That is, yes, this is the diffuse term, that whatever we have got, that is 1 by a plus bt plus cd square kd into ld max of l dot n comma 0, okay, plus this is the specular term ks into ls max of r dot v raised to alpha comma 0, okay, and the final one is, this is the ambient term, okay. So this is our Phong equation, okay. This is our Phong equation, and this equation we are going to use in our teapot lab program. Okay, teapot lab program. Okay, but we are not going to use the equation like this. Some OpenGL commands are there. With the help of that command, we are going to just specify the values. Okay, now next one is the modified Phong model. Okay, here this Phong model is having some drawbacks. Okay, to overcome from this one, we are going to use this modified Phong model, or also we call it as a Blinn Phong model. Okay, if we use the Phong model with the specular reflections in our rendering, the dot product, okay, that is nothing but r dot v, should be recalculated at every point on the surface. Yes, so assume that if this is the point, okay, and I got the r and v, okay, but assume that our surface is not flat, but the surface is curved. Okay, so whenever I change my point position P, okay, if I'm traversing, if I'm moving from this point to that point, okay, so every time we have to calculate this this angular distance between the R and V, okay, because whenever we change the position, okay, on the curved surfaces, R and V also get changed. Okay, so to obtain the specular term for this type of cases, okay, we will use another unit length vector, that is half a vector. Okay, this half a vector h is between the v vector and the light source. Okay, it is the half a vector is the vector, okay, which comes in between the viewer vector and the light source vector. Okay, in between these two, light and the viewer, okay, we will get this halfway. Okay, so this h is equals to l plus v divided by, okay, the modulus of l plus v. Okay, whereas psi is the angle between the normal vector and halfway vector. Okay, that we call as a halfway angle. Okay, but here you can see that if the normal is in the direction of the halfway vector. See here, if the normal is in the direction of the halfway vector, both halfway vector and normal vector both are near to each other, then the maximum reflection from the surface is in the direction of the viewer, okay, which indicates that this particular viewer and the reflection are very near to each other, okay, which indicates that as this halfway vector, okay, reaches near to the normal vector, similarly the viewer vector also reaches towards the reflection vector, okay. When the V lies in the same plane as 2, L, N and R, we have 2 psi equals to phi, means this is psi is 2 times, okay, shorter than the psi, okay, shorter than the phi, okay. So in the specular we have already used, okay, that is IS equals to KS LS max of R dot V raised to alpha comma 0. But here we are going to change. So in place of r dot v, we are going to use n dot h. Okay, n dot h we are going to use. Okay, what is n dot h? N dot h is nothing but a cos psi. Okay, so the cos psi is smaller than the cos phi. Okay, and we use the same exponent e. Okay, that was n dot h raised to e. Okay, so here we have used alpha, right? So here we are going to use. Okay, so just a renaming, nothing else. Okay, concept is remaining as same. Okay, so we are going to use e. Okay, what is e? E is nothing but it is a shininess coefficient. Okay, so finally, what is the equation that we will get here? We will get, with respect to the modified Phong model, we will get IS equals to KS LS max of n dot h raised to alpha comma 0. Okay, this is the final equation for the modified Phong model. Okay, so this completes your modified Phong model. Okay, so and in this particular model, okay, we are remaining with the Cohen-Sutherland line clipping algorithm. Okay, that we will do in the next class. Okay, so here I'm going to stop. Okay, thanks for listening.